identify and accountable extremists now speaking out to denounce terror and extremism.
30,000 people formed a human chain in the South this afternoon in the name of peace.
We're asking if religious intolerance is on the rise.
We believe that religious freedom is a fundamental human right.
Giving a message that Islam is a religion of peace.
We must all endeavor to spread love and a sense of community.
In the name of God, the gracious and merciful. May the peace and blessings of Almighty God be upon you. Welcome to this, the 11th episode of Press Point. Today, we're looking at the Arab Spring and the wider Arab conflict and crisis which is facing this part of the world. We're looking at a number of countries in particular which are going to take a focus on Syria, but we're going to look at the global impact of this crisis. But not only are we looking at the crisis, we're also looking at solutions, and we're particularly interested in what Islam can offer to the world and to the Arab nations in order to bring about peace and harmony within this region. Now, as ever, I'm joined by my very good friend and brother, Bruce Andrews, in the studio.
Well, Jonathan, yes, of course, today is a very important topic to discuss, and somebody said that the Arab world is bleeding. And so you're all very concerned. We're discussing about why that is happening. If you are affected, either physically or emotionally, please do stay with us. Send us the tweets or the emails to presspointnk.tv. Tweet us using the hashtag presspointnk. Please stay with us and we share with the community as well by the way. So your participation is paramount.
And what very good as well. We're glad to have two great guests in the studio today. On my immediate left, a good friend and brother, Ibrahim Al-Fasad. Ibrahim, of course, is the head of the Arab Press Desk. So, Press Value is coming from Ibrahim. As well, we have familiar faces for the research, of course, from the International Press Desk. Some of them are very good happy with the research. As well, second study, we have two side guests. We have Tamim Abu Bakr, who is from Jordan, who represents with a particular focus on the Syrian problems that are facing in that region, and also the Jordanian refugee crisis. We also have Tamim Yunusab, who comes over from the USA. And he will be giving his insight into the global aspects, and particularly the American continent as well.
Esther, thank you very much. Of course, this is a show very difficult to cover in 1 hour. We'll start off with some very quick insights to what we're talking about. Arab League is an organization which is made up of 22 countries. Of course, most of it is suffering quite a lot. Of course, we see on my screen if you can. Here, North Africa and the Middle East countries are actually part of this. Arab League, for example, North Africa, Algeria, there we've got Egypt, Saudi Arabia, very good country, under that is Yemen, and of course, this is Sudan here. And all these countries are bleeding, and above there is Syria. So, clearly, we are going to talk about Arab League as to what's happening over there. This one article was published on BBC a few days back, actually, and they said Arab League have been effectively quite non-existent, and they haven't really done anything specific to resolve problems in the Middle East. Ever since it was created back in 1945, there have been factions within this Arab League. The next slide, you can see that it's been news on Iran online. Yemen is experiencing fighting regimes after sanctions. Yemen may not be coming on news that often, but again, there's a problem in Yemen. North of Yemen, which is just under Saudi Arabia, has also seen a lot of fighting going on between the Islam Sunni sects, the Sunni Muslims and the Shia Muslims. That's also going to be a big problem. And then this international gives a story, or a very worrying sort of a story of 2 years of conflict ever since Libya, which is what happened 2 years ago there, but still there is plight of displaced communities. What really concerns us is that real short paragraph, the entire inhabitants of the town of Tawangra, some 40,000 people, were driven out by armed forces on goods from Israel, who accused them of supporting Colonel al-Gaddafi's government. So clearly all that is gone, but still people don't forgive other people around them, and that problem is still escalating. And then towards the real issue the world is facing now, which is really causing a lot of anxiety, Syrian conflict, of course, indeed, more than 100,000 people already died, and then more than 200,000, 2 million of the Syrians have fled out of Syria, uprooted to other countries like the country of Israel. To Jordan, to Egypt, to other neighboring countries, I think, like also Lebanon and North of Africa. And there are hopefully talks going to take place in December, but things like even that is under a lot of threat because people against that who are the opposition forces within Syria. I think we should probably move on before we can talk further on this.
as well as some of the tragedy that's happening on these stages across the globe, across the region. You know, Arabs and then the Muslim world, we've recorded that is really suffering a great deal and there's been tragedy taking place. And Ibrahim, what is causing this turmoil and these conflicts for the bullies in our world? What are those all causes that we put in the
but there are many reasons, political reasons, economic reasons, even religious. In my religious reasons, this also has a very big role, you know, for all these problems. I think especially, unfortunately, after the independence of those Arab countries, those leaders never received justice. They still force the country. They think that for population, especially the public, is very cruel, never gave them the due rights, despise their rights. And from the other side, Taqwa, the Holy Quran ever speaks, you know, they're very suggestive about Taqwa. Taqwa means to you, they will make a conscience from both sides, the public as well as the leaders, you know, to have this consciousness to protect their country, you know, from external and internal dangers. And you could see it after that, you know, after those some countries, people, they start to imitate the Muslims and other countries, the Western philosophy, let us start to be rebellious. Let us start to demonstrate and protest. And this created a kind of chaos, although it was better for them. As the Holy Prophet said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, peace of them, he ceased it for days and all days, wherever, even if your leader is oppressive, and God is the one who will answer to your prayers. That's important.
World War II and before that as well, there's an amount of Asian governments not delivering the due rights of the people, but then also more broadly, a sense of revolution taking place, which maybe isn't necessarily for the correct Islamic concept. We started in a sense right across the Middle East, but then it's come to a recent island within Syria as almost the formula of the tinderbox that is terrifying the world and the potential consequences of it. What are some of the factors that you've been given an overview within Syria? What are some of the factors that have led to this factor that you've been in our history?
Syria is one of those countries which has followed this place that we call the Arab Spring after Tunisia. And at the time of the Arab Spring again, there was this almost unrealistic hope that there would be widespread change across the Arab world. Tunisia, Libya, and then Syria. Really that the Arab Spring hasn't offered a consistent solution to the sorts of problems that the West is suggesting that revolution, or even perhaps people on the ground, are suggesting that revolution might bring. The reality is that in Syria, what we're finding is a disastrous situation where there's sectarianism, there's outside influence, not just from other countries, but also from extremist groups that are now coming into Syria. And destroying the possibility of real peace. You know, clearly the thing you mentioned earlier on the beginning of this program, it's just happened at the end of November, and perhaps the 2nd of December, even that may not happen, and partly that's as a result of some of the unrealistic conditions being set for the outcome of those peace negotiations. So it's a very complicated situation, but I would just say at the end of this piece that it doesn't necessarily matter what sort of government you have, whether you have a monarchy or you have a democracy or another. What should happen is that whoever is in power must ensure that they fulfill the rights of the people on the ground, and as everybody else has also said, people on the ground also fulfill their responsibilities as citizens of the country. And that really is a central ethos for successful money processing. But then the dual rights of not only a difference on the rights of the state or the duty of the state and the rights of the individual, but also the duty of the individual to be peaceful, to be harmonious, and for the state to ensure that everybody has their political freedoms and their economic needs being met, essentially, which is clearly, you know, badly absent across many of the states. And on the basis of religion, because that's an important point, the freedom of information is one absolutely not. I think it's time to not revolt that bit of corruption here. And you've also been looking at a lot of the tragedies of the refugee crisis that are within the conflict.
Whoever is responsible, I think the reality is that the government is involved in the rule, they all stop rising without any logic behind it, of course, is affecting the boys and other levels and breaking down country reality. People are suffering, humans are suffering. We are looking at, if you can see my screen, UNHCR's website, the UN Refugee Agency has published this map here of the neighboring countries, Jordan, Cyprus, Turkey, Iraq, these countries around that. And of course, the refugees are ending up in Jordan, Iraq, Turkey, Egypt. And the numbers they mention are over 2.2 million at the moment, which of course is rising very fast. Of that, 2.126 million people have been registered, remaining 86,000 are yet to be registered. But what really worries the most is the data here, the demography of these people actually. If you look at the females plus the males under the age of 11, for example, they add up to about 38%. And 38% of 2.2 million is a significant number. And if you put it to the 17 years or under, it's over 50%. It means more than a million of them are very young people, the future is in jeopardy, apparently. And if you look at this line chart here, the graph there, has been rising so steep. So start of this year, January 2013, it's been going up very steep, and at the moment it stands at 2.2 million. Now, based on that, if I can speak to my brother, Benin from Jordan, if he's not here, but Benin, can you hear me at all?
Yes, I can hear you.
I'm
going
to let you know. I'm from, you know, we have just mentioned 2.2 million people actually are the ones who have left or fled their homeland to Syria. And your country, Jordan, had, I think, received about over 500,000 individuals. What do you think are going to be social implications, like young people going to their education, for example, and also how does social fabric work then do the host nation people invite and welcome people from outside? How does it, how are we seeing that here?
Actually, well, this figure that you mentioned, maybe this is a quick figure, but we have much more students here in Jordan, because some of them, they came not at refugee status, but they just moved to Jordan. And let's say the total number is almost. The other thing, actually, also you should bear in mind, the internal displacement, which is really a very big problem, because maybe almost at least 4 million are internally displaced, and their situation is not better than the situation of the refugees and the neighboring country. In Jordan, of course, do not have the capacity to absorb this number of refugees. Some of them are refugee camps in the north. Some of them are inside the Jordanian city. They are working now in poor, let's say, conditions. I mean, they are used sometimes by some employers. Employees, and they are really suffering, even if they are not in the refugee camps. The issue of
your voice is not very clear, so I think because of the poor connection with Skype, we've got to come back to inshallah later on. Of course, he's mentioning that the issue is far greater than it looks. Official figures are much lower than what the reality is. Those are the more you've got in mind up.
Yeah. Well, we'll come back to Jordan for the look at the refugee crisis when we can get a stronger line. We're going to be seeing that if this was a lot of refugees. But particularly as what the reality is like, four refugees leaving the Syrian crisis, and we've seen very powerful documentaries in some ways. We're still short fixing this for the people who suggest that this is even the reality of things.
She's 83 at the maximum. She's also a student of refugees.
Thank you.
brothers and sisters, which is mixed with just relevant about it. But God is quite sure that he's doing the education of his children, boys and girls alike. Power has not been to school for 2 years now, and a little prospect of going to
the central use of most horrific weapon of all, the nuclear bomb. And that is very, very horrific picture that we can see before us by Divine Divine Khalifa of the Almighty Allah. And here, this picture is my favorite personally. That is always reading prayer within the vicinity of the Parliament of Beijing. A very good man of God. He loves human beings and cares about humans, and then he goes to God again to pray. So,
and this is a very really useful point, because I think it's really needed. At some point, there must be a solution. This is not a solution that we have to do with story from the but in particular, we've heard from Gregory that potentially maybe the solution lies within the United Nations. We need to get a piece of analysis of it. So what do you know about it? Let's say this in the United context, we're obviously revised to 10%. What's hope is that for this, and why is this so important for the United
States? Exactly what I was going to say. There is no solution except the food at the level of what the Muslim world can consume. The world has nothing with this kind of solution. But what the Holy Quran makes it clearly, a very important point. The Quran is inspired by two statements. He said, the difference between the Western countries and the Muslim countries, the Western people have been derived to the human beings, but not to God. And you Muslims are not being derived, the human beings from just to God. But in this case, as you explain and go to the Holy Quran, and the Holy Quran says, only the chief of human beings should refer all your dispute to Allah and His Messenger. And go to the Holy Quran, as well as the Holy Prophet, in his days, to make it very clear, only the dispute between the Muslims or any fight which to be sold or restored justice in the Muslim nations. It was, as Tariq now mentioned, the Arab movement for the Arab League, for whom he comes go wider the league of all the Muslims, or the Muslim arrived, as he said, the Muslim land, but the Arab League, the British people have united and came with a plan to establish without any vested interest in Syria or any Arab country with such a problem at the moment or crisis. In this case, there's no one further evil. He said, when they fight with each other, you could solve it without letting any Western country interfere in the situation. And when, if at that moment he sends Gosser or whatever, he continues to persist in attacking the citizens, what he should do, the Arabs should have, you know, united. They could put stones, you know, restrictions, attacking or whatever. But if it's not Gosser, stop, let's be, and he wants to come back against the resistance, the Muslim countries would still have given him this opportunity. And what is rather here says, please, when you are trying to do it in a good way for Vera, please don't come with preconditions. We want that guy, as I said, in Syria, or we want him first to go down the coast in his just serving agenda. It's my power.
What is fighting all these things is if it is sovereignty to the nations themselves, it's democratic in that sense, but it's also directly guided by the authority they have, and this is what it is, as I'm talking about. And it would be the reason mentioned, of course, by something like last year, talked about 30 years, so that there are Western powers now involved, and certainly with the, of course, with the chemical destructions, deprivation, and destruction of chemical weapons, but this is very much now engaged with not only the local Arab powers, but also the global superpowers, and they're having an influence. And there's a real risk, potentially. What are those risks? And then why should we be concerned? Would you say
as has been mentioned here, that Kabila has mentioned in his speech, and it's not just recent speech, but I think in every major speech that has worked for 7 days, he has been making reports about justice and has mentioned Syria and a large number of Kabilis. The reason why EOS OIC is the right organization to try and bring about the peace treaty here is because the OIC is a conglomerate of 7 Muslim countries. At the moment, when you look at the situation in Syria and the Arab region on the ground, you have blocks. You've got Saudi on one hand, you've got Russia, you've got the United States, you've got Iran, you have Lebanon. There are a number of different countries that are involved, each of which have a different political interest. And when the director says all of these countries basically fight for one government, what it is saying is that all of these countries are Muslims. And because they are Muslims,
they should deal with this, as Abraham has quite rightly said, using Islamic means and Islamic theology, the practice of the Prophet Muhammad and what is in the Holy Quran. And when you do that, you then put aside those political differences. There's enough for interest. And you look at things as a whole, and so when 57 countries of the OIC come together and try and resolve the issues of other Muslim countries, because those national interests are put aside, you are in a much better position to come to a resolution than you would be if you were to exclude the OIC and then deal with this on the basis of political blocks that are handled. The people you mentioned from the political blocks, and what a major political influence of course is the American government government in the USA. So let's go to the USA, and let's put together for him and somebody else to say about this. Islamic and biblical theme, can you hear us on track?
Thank you very much for having me on. Yes, I can hear you.
Exactly. So we've heard in the studio from Ibrahim, and Brother Ibrahim and Brother Khalil, that this needs to be resolved within the region, and there needs to be real democracy and sovereignty given to those nations, and unity amongst the Arab states. Of course, your nation, the American nation, has a strong role to play here, and they are playing a strong role. So what role should the U.S. be playing here? I guess this is perhaps a broader question, but in particular, what are the risks, and the people who have talked about this, what are the risks of Western powers in becoming involved in the Syrian conflict and within the Arab region as a whole, and how is this playing out at the moment from your angle over the U.S.?
Sure, I think the way you and some of the other guests have already mentioned, the police of Islam has said it over and over again, the risk is not just a perception of U.S. yet again looking to engage in another imperialistic war, but the bigger risk is of this conflict escalating into a third world war. So that has been repeatedly said. What is encouraging for me as an American to see is that I'm seeing America increasingly as a war-weary country. What I mean by that I still remember in the aftermath of 9/11, when America wanted to invade militarily in Afghanistan, there was an 86%. Gallup had, and CNN came out with a poll back then, 80% of Americans supported that invasion. By the time it was 2003, 2 years later, and Iraq came, that number dropped to 64%. 64% Americans supported the war in Iraq. By the time you get to Libya in 2001, just at the beginning of Arab Spring, that number dropped to 56%. So just 56% of Americans supported enforcing a no-fly zone over Libya. And a couple of months ago, when there was a lot of war fever as to whether America will go in Syria, about 60% of Americans opposed that invasion. So if you look at that trend, it is clearly going in the right direction, which is that America should not militarily engage in a lot of these Muslim countries, where the issues are very complicated. There is a lot of intra-faith strife. You know, before we go to interfaith religion and issues, you know, we all know the Sunni and Shia split and the role Iran and Saudi Arabia are playing, and none of that is a secret. So I think what Khalifa of Islam is saying is prophetic at this moment.
Just to say, to come back to one of them, what role would you, as an Anglo Muslim living within America, what sort of role do you think the your nation and the wider Western nations should be playing with this, and how does that spread and complement the role of Arab nations? It's a quite a broad question, but how can the American nation help to actually bring about peace within this region, would you say?
Sure, you know, there's a very famous hardware chain right here in America, it's called Home Depot. So if you want to have anything fixed in your house, you go to Home Depot, and I love their slogan. Because their slogan is, you can do it, we can help. You know, they won't come and fix the leaky faucet in your home, but you can go and find all the supplies that you need. And I think that exactly is the role of America in today's global world. We cannot be isolationists, because anything that happens in China will impact New York within 24 hours. We cannot be isolationists, but we have to play the role of a facilitator. We have to use our leverage according to the principles of absolute justice. I'll give you a very quick example. A 16-year-old called me a couple of years ago when there was a major Israeli-Palestinian conflict going on. This boy was up in arms, you know, of course, his blood was boiling. And we had a long chat on the phone, and I somehow convinced him to write it. I said, you know, why don't you channel all this energy and write a letter to the editor? and really become a part of the solution, because that's what democracies do. This kid that same night wrote a profound letter, and essentially he said that every time there is a conflict between Israel and Palestine, America always says that we will stand by Israel, and Egypt always says that we will stand by Palestine. He said peace cannot be established until each side says that they will stand by justice. So this is what a 16-year-old in America is saying. And I find that profound, because that's precisely the teaching of what Khalifah Islam has been telling us, that you support each other in goodness and in justice and fairness, but don't go into these countries only for ulterior motives or national interests, quote-unquote. The moment we say national interest, we lose the trust, because people know that we are only there to secure our interests. We are not there to solve the problem. And that is something which has been sold to us Americans for decades now. People believe that, okay, for national interest, it's okay to wage a war. Yes. Now we are seeing that, no, there are multiple side effects of that strategy.
So clear message with self-determination for the Arab nations. You can do it, we can help. I think that's a very, very powerful message, very simple, pithy statement that this can be used. And I think that's probably what the British people said, or the British Parliament said in Britain, in many ways. I think it was perhaps resonating with that concept of being really supporting the case of Islam and say that the best place for this is within the Arab region itself. So I know you've been taking a wide lot of work to Israel and some of the other countries surrounding this conflict. What have you found?
Well, I think, of course, I'm still thinking about what Brother Hughes mentioned. I think a very positive outlook that the American people understand this, what it is a positive impression. But looking at the news, it's quite different. Looking at, first of all, let's start with Bloomberg. One channel is probably people who like finance would know this. They say the Russian accused Syria arms while enjoying the push for talk. What it's saying is, in fact, the US ambassador to Syria has complained that Russia is still playing a very active role in escalating the problem. And this Robert Ford says that Russian military aid was substantial, and in some cases militarily extremely significant in Syria, helping to say Hezbollah on the east side of Syria. But if you compare that with the next news, which is on BBC, CBC, I don't know if I think in Canada, that's a map which I think one piece of speech volumes about what's happening is 600 words, 800 words. This is the region that's really under massive threat of war. But look at the things around it. US Navy destroyers, submarines, aircraft carriers, then US air bases. So on the one end, this investigation is in fact invading through helping with arms and ammunition. On the other side, America is also actively physically present there, which does worry many people, and I'm sure the American public will be quite concerned. And looking at this Syria conflict, Israel carries out an attack here in Syria. That story from the beginning of this month, actually. This is another interesting story where Israel, Americans said that Russian-made missiles were actually attacked by the Israeli aircraft and clearly that is, of course, confirmed by the American plane now, but on both sides, Syrian government outlets, Israel have been quite naked about this. We don't know why that is the case, but that's very concerning. And Kevin Connolly, one of the BBC correspondents in Jerusalem, says that Israeli air raids on military targets inside Syria have become one of the strangest subplots of civil war. And then, this really makes it very messy, very complicated situation. Now, Syria crisis, again, Guardian newspaper in the UK says, Saudi Arabia has spent millions to train new rebel forces. Now, analyzing these news, apparently Saudi Arabia has been very quiet, and apparently a lot is happening through Saudi Arabian government, matter of fact. That really worries many people. People will say the Western powers like America and Britain become the bad cops. But in reality, you see, Saudi Arabia has a massive stake. It's a very big stakeholder. What they're doing here in this news is very, very scary news. They are preparing an army or a group of people called Jaish al-Islam with the presence of 550,000 individuals and they're seeking Pakistan's help to train those people. And they will be excluding Al-Qaeda affiliates in that group of people who will be fighting the Syrian government. Now, isn't that very, very worrying? We already have produced Taliban and Al-Qaeda and so on and so forth. Now you come up with a new force called Jaish al-Islam and it's happening in Syria. So, those prophetic words more and more resonate.
Okay. and what we could benefit from is maybe to go over to them again, if we have got a community on the line, perhaps to ask them to help us how effective your ways to use actually doing this process. Stanley, can you bring it around to me?
Yes,
I'm from Salah, from So, we've had a lot of focus on right with the one hour of making, we're based in Jordan. If we can put this question to you, how effective do you think the Arab nations are collectively at the moment in bringing about peace in the region? And are they having a real impact on the crisis? And is it a positive one? We've just heard from Brother Farouk that there is some worrying developments, perhaps not peaceful developments, but actually aggressive developments. What from over in Jordan, how well have your rights been bringing about this principle of justice in the Arab region?
Yes, actually, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Actually, the situation, as Brother Farouk mentioned, as he showed all of these reports through the media and the news, the situation now is very complicated. And it's actually, we can say it very frankly and very simply that the Third World War has taken place, but in small scope. Everybody is participating. And unfortunately, the Arab countries are not intervening positively. They are actually helping one side against the other side, and they are not looking to have justice in Syria. And what makes it worse, actually, the superpowers are supporting some groups of the Arab nations, which are, let's say, on one side, and the other superpower is also supporting another group, which means this is so much escalating the crisis and make it so complicated. And unfortunately, it is not anymore a civil war in Syria. It's a war between the superpowers and also between two groups of the Arab world. And actually, it got now a very dangerous dimension, which is the sectarian dimension. So any kind of intervention now from one side cannot be, is not possible, first of all. I mean, the positive intervention, because the other side will look at it as it is supporting one group against another group. So, sadly, the situation, and I don't think actually the situation.
Okay, just an idea, which is no problem for him. It's a clear message, isn't it? In fact, the resonance of what Brother Farouk said, that this movement is not a small, it's not a localized conflict. This has the potential to not only be a regional conflict, but potentially to be a global conflict. It could have huge ramifications if this was an nuclear war. Brother Farouk, I think you've done very good use of research, and you've come across the many times as a convention, is the intervention of the
let's have a look at a couple of pieces of
content.
Again, I think what we're hearing here is it's all really what's happening, and really it's very scary in different massive portion of the world actually suffering. And on a daily basis, the problems are becoming from that to worse, and now almost the same. It's also a very holy war, but let's go to the prayers and prayers of the book. And all other good things in the world, the world comes back to this part of the structure. We have a couple of tweets. Thank you, Imam Khan, have a regular viewer in the States. The Arab nations to resolve the issues amongst themselves, never allow foreign powers to intervene. Clear message. And then Sufyan Farouk says, basic speech, advice, and what should be in the Arab world, which took advice from Khalifa Islam. Foreign nations should not intervene. That really is something which worries most of us, anyway, what's happening. Now, as you have asked me to talk about the LA Times newspaper, in May, the month of May, was always there in the US and in the West Coast of that country, and again, spoke to a number of dignitaries and convinced them in his own way through the Quranic teaching of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and the world needs to come back in the path of peace. This is a picture of us all. This is an interview taken by Carol J. Williams of LA Times. I'll only quote one of the questions he asked at all. She said, how does the international community go about restoring peace in the region? Now, Iraq's by war and by deposition. And I quote a few answers. He says,
A few months back, President Shimon Peres of Israel said the UN should send forces into these conflicted countries, but only forces comprised of Arab soldiers, not Western troops. It is the proper role of neighbors to get together and try to stop the conflict in their region. It's the duty of neighboring countries to stop the prosecution of Syria. Now, this means begs the question: do we have Brother Fahim online at the moment? Salamu Brother Fahim, are you there?
Well, it's done. Yes, I'm here.
Excellent. Now, listening to that sort of statement about Hazrul, of course, who was referred to what Shimon Peres has said, how do you respond to those people when they ask a question that such a man of a huge statement and status of Islam, Hazrul Amir al-Mu'mineen, is advising people to pay heed to a non-Muslim Shimon Peres? How do you view that?
See, that is, this really shows the irony of the Muslim world, that they have excluded their best people, that this is the leader, this is the voice in Islam, which actually is professing the fourth condition that we all know of, that we all need to be kind, do no harm to the creatures of Allah in general and Muslims in particular, neither by our tongue or by hand. So here is a man who is taking immense risk when he quotes Shimon Peres, in my opinion. No politician would ever do that, because no politician in Pakistan would dare do that. But only you have to have a very direct hotline with Allah or your Creator in order to have that level of clarity. Because Holy Quran clearly mentions the principle that when you elect your leaders, they don't have to be Muslims. You elect someone who's trustworthy, someone who's strong, you know, someone who will do justice. So Hazur is essentially trying to put all the right pieces together, help them see those pieces, that a voice of justice, wherever it comes from, you must take it, you must listen to that, and if it happens to be Shimon Peres or Israeli president, big deal. You know, we are about justice and establishing peace. And in my opinion, this pretty much puts that contrast between a politician and a spiritual leader, because a politician would never make that statement.
Of course, it was also been referring to the Quranic and Holy Prophet's teachings in that respect. What do you say about that? It's just one particular example of a statement. I remember how goes to Bethlehem when Brother Fahim Yunus says, he said, this is the man or the difference between spiritual and democratic people. You know, Hazrul, of course, is a reflection of Muhammad from a person in the sense of the reason for their humanity. And he won Hazrul Rasul to Shimon Peres in the press release. He said, he quoted the narration of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him. He said, in this narration, the Holy Prophet says, a believer is someone, wherever he finds a word of good advice, or any wisdom, you know, he acquires it, or quotes it, as this is the lost property of the Muslim. Who has not said, don't focus here on who said it. Doesn't matter. Believer, Hindu, Christian, doesn't matter. This word is according to justice, honest, he came with his tradition, and it doesn't matter whether it's a human Paris or Obama or whoever. And this has a particular, you know, emphasis on this. I think what the human Yunus started with, it's impossible for anyone to call this the Holy Prophet of Islam.
I think another key point is that to what extent are you looking at the international level in particular? You have mentioned the United Nations last week. What role should the United Nations be playing? Because we've, of course, talked about the Western division, talked about America with their superpower role. But to what extent should the UN be engaging in that? And if so, in which way can they reach these people to the principle of justice within the Syrian crisis, but within the wider Arab region as a whole, which is that?
That's my view, is that the UN is probably the most powerful political force that there is, you know, on this planet. But the problems with the Middle East could bring the result of the Muslim country rather than the United Nations. I think that's a bit limited. The role of the United Nations is to support the interests of all of its member countries, not just the peace. And what's just happened is that the perspectives and views of the majority of the most powerful countries have been imposed from the majority of smaller countries in a way that harms the interests of those
smaller countries. So whilst the United Nations overall is an organization that's done very good things in the years, fantastic humanitarian work, is it? 5 billion dollars field has been raised in relation to Syria, backed by the United Nations recently, in terms of the Security Council, that was not providing the same level of support to the Nations. And this, of course, is the fate of its predecessor, the League of Nations, and its failure to look after the interests of all nations of the whole way to the Second World War, that is what is mentioned there. And so the United Nations, to the Security Council, needs to very carefully how it goes about making these decisions so that it does secure peace and justice. And I would also say that Vladimir Putin did very well in ensuring that he reined back the rest of the world in taking military action in Syria, and by bringing about the chemical weapon deal. So now, at least, the reverse of what sort of doing is military capacity. But how do you office of how you've gone a little bit further than said, well, you know, the 5 billion powers that are currently in the Security Council, that if they were also reform, and that would mean that the Security Council would be much more representative of the countries that are part of its membership rather than the major interests of those countries.
I guess this is the common criticism of England is that if it's well, you know, there are 100 or more countries within the UN, if you hold to be a power and people often fight the Security Council as part of the within it. Since we have talked about a positive role that the UN might be able to play, and potentially there's nothing the nations play together collectively to play a positive role in terms of peace and justice. So it'd be interesting, I believe, to think about Islamism and what sort of guidance can we get from the Quran in terms of the powerful nations, the UN as a whole. Islamism, what sort of role should these nations be playing? And how does God Almighty in the Quran guide the UN, for instance, in dealing with problems of Syria and dealing with the Arab Spring crisis?
Again, I think that the solution for this question, of course, lies in the Holy Quran. But don't make it like it. Don't, because of any enmity, and started by any enmity towards any nation, but don't, because of this history and any injustice. This is very important. But before I speak with Brother Khalil about this point, you know, whenever you read in the Holy Quran, the Holy Quran promotes justice. And peace is just a natural outcome of justice. The peace in scripture, what does it mean? Who are the immigrants? And someone in the Holland, by the way, speaking, to get totally restored, no any dispensation in this country for this country or for Holland, it has proven the U.S. to be useful sacrifice to prove that it should benefit both countries, or at least one country specialist for over, not both of anything at the cost of a special and for the nation. And if one has no problem with the United Nations, but the only problem, and Brother Kalista had explained this point, it seems now that we have a more healthy nation instead of the United Nations. Especially, as I said, after the independence, not just the Israeli and the Palestinian problems. The United Nations, unfortunately, I don't want to go in depth, so much, you know, emphasizing on the state of the security of Israel. They can expand their country, they can do whatever, but they have no help for Palestinians. This issue is already supported for Syria for 70 years. The answer of the United Nations, all of others, cut the heads, let the bank of them, or the open back, or whatever. Will we bring peace? Do we see peace? No. And the only thing, as I can go, Brother Khalil has explained it, unfortunately, all the decisions taken regarding the Middle East, especially, not all, but mostly, were answered decisions influenced by the lobbying groups, by other powerful groups. There is no room for any United Nations, but on one condition, all of these systems should be based on justice.
Okay, well, this is perfectly with what you've been telling us, Philip, from the teachings and everything, and the guidance of the teachers, and the really the key principle here is justice, and very, very simple for me,
isn't it? Very effective. Brother Hassan has been very vulnerable for the next, I think, I was planning beforehand. It was again about that Quran in verse, actually, and it was almost Friday 7th, 15th of September, actually, was pretty much expounded on the same topic as well. Just quickly quote what he said, really, on that day, and that Quran in verse, which says, as we say, God states the guidance of situation, and if two parties of believers fight against each other, make peace between them.
but it's after that one of their transgressors against the other, fight with part of the transgressor on the other side of the command of Allah. Then if it returns, make peace between them with equity and act justly. And again, the one that you mentioned was also that and let not of people's enmity and strife to threat otherwise than the justice. First one being, of course, the 49th chapter, which is asked for the Quran.
But you need to make this important to some extent as well, because this doesn't only draw upon the duties of the nations across the world, but it also draws upon the duties of individuals within countries. And this is where we started today with the beginning of the WWE given as part of the promise. What would be interesting actually is if we go to Jordan, Stanley from Brother Camino, are you online? I guess the global context or the regional context within this building balloon showing this acceptance is one of the revolution that's taking place across really the Middle East. Jordan hasn't seen this revolution itself. And it would be interesting to say what are the duties on individuals within these countries, within these Arab nations, not only the states themselves, but what are their duties as Muslims in order to bring about peace within their own lives, within their families, within their communities, and within their nations? How should they respond to the great upheaval that's taking place around them at the moment? What's the value for Islam on this?
Yes, actually, regardless of Islam, it's so clear about this. Actually, Islam is asking us to discharge the rights of others and to concentrate on discharging the rights of others and to be just to others and then not to be limited, to be just to others and fair to others. We should be doing charity, which means something about what they deserve, what you think they deserve. And we should not be demand-oriented. This is the main principle of Islam, which are always repeated at every Friday sermon and the second part of the sermon, which is to remind the Muslims all the time what is Islam. Islam is not concentrating on what you think. These are your rights. You should concentrate on what duty you have to do. You have to discharge against others. So for the average people or for the citizens of the Arab world, they should concentrate on their duty and they should be just to the government. And they should, even if they want to give advice to the government, they should do it according to the Islamic way, which is not through doing demonstrations and creating rage on the streets and making points which will be eventually affecting everybody in the country and will weaken the country and will also give the opportunity for the foreign power to interfere in the country and to make it very much complicated problem as what happened in Syria, as we mentioned.
Can I continue with another question? And, we don't have a lot of time, so I might have to be quite a brief answer if it's possible. But a lot of brothers within the UK, are through conversations. It's well known, and through the news, it's well known that a lot of people, tragically, Muslims, are actually leaving this country to go to Somalia, to go to Syria, in order to fight what they consider to be a jihad. And they believe it's their religious duty to go to Syria in order to fight against Bashar al-Assad. You're in Jordan, you're close to the region. Islamically, is this correct, or is that completely false?
That's completely false. Because actually, it has nothing to do, the fight in Syria has nothing to do with their classic jihad. Actually, this is just some of the clarities. They are trying to use the people for their own advantage and for the advantage of the country or the power that they are working for. It has nothing to do with Islamic jihad. Are the Muslims in Syria are fought because of their religion? Are they fought because Bashar al-Assad is asking them to request not to be a Muslim? The conflict between two powers, between unfortunately two states, and these two states are developed into physical states, not anymore. It is a crime against these people who are convinced by these models and these movies are advising them to go there.
Okay, excellent. So we've talked again to the commission, given that this is a regional conflict that has been solved by the Arab nations It's not a religious conflict. It's not based upon a question of a religious minority or upon Muslim practice in their faith. In fact, it's rooted in much deeper and more tragic political and economic issues. So the answer is, this isn't quite clearly one. But if we can be, I think it's been some interesting truths in this, how we can achieve this injustice in Western.
Things haven't been as innocent as the other ones. But when we think of one, this is from Philip Isar, and so the rules are just going to follow Mr. Salon's parents, but not Mr. Salon, someone not on his friends, says he has no vested interest and has a pure desire for peace, says Philip Isar, and a very sensible point. This is where another story I want to bring in here very quickly. Let's take another positive. We know Turkey and Iran have been very much like the opposite sides. The recent stories come up, which is personally heartening, that the shared concern of Syria brings fall between Turkey and Iran. What's happening here is the Foreign Minister of Turkey has said that we may have disagreements, but if we can't present a common position on the future of the Middle East, or particularly Tashkent, we will all have to bear the consequences of this. So clearly, as we all understand, we all have different perspectives, we all have different reasons why to support one side or the other, but because the objective is just to extend that peace and all to work together without any problems
whatsoever. So this comes from nice to talk to me, this is the future, and where are we going? Where's the Arab region going? What's the future of the Syrian people? And so, for the program we've seen, you know, as a minister of the year today, what is that future look like? If I can think a bit of in between and ask you that question, you may want to bring in some of the early points as well, but particularly, you don't have a lot of time left, but where do you see your story in the future, and what do you think the Syrian crisis in particular? And before asking this question, because it's going to be a straightforward whenever the people of the lower deck, the public, they wanted weapons, they had to go to the upper deck. Yes? But what happened, those people, the authority, made it so difficult for them, inconvenience, they were simply left with something else. Let's put a hole here in the boat, and we'll get weapons very easily. But after the book was done, there was no motion. So the logic here is never do the businesses. It's the coming steps, and the Friday sermon is open. You know, bothered by this suggestion, Quran, put the charges to the Muslim people, however, never be transgressed, never be the charges against the government. Okay, so the key message from simply how the Jewish crisis has peaked, and as much as I don't know if it's actually this, but it is the charges. What about yourself? I mean, we've got the Jewish crisis, but what are you seeing for the future? And how perhaps can the nations, the Arab nations, help to bring about this in the middle of the Arab nations?
Syria is the nation that can spend that long because it's a catastrophic situation on the ground. And so the very first thing to say is that the situation cannot be resolved in the terrain. And any attempt to resolve it in the terrain is more than likely going to be a regional conflict. The Syria is a very well for one. That's not just us, but the remaining highly respected communities. Sector of the world are always concerned the same thing. So that means that the very first thing is then this ceasefire. So fighting needs to stop and the countries need to come round the table and have a discussion that will finally lead to a just settlement. And that discussion must be without preconditions. There's no logic in saying that any discussion, for instance, between the two ministers of Israel itself must step down and must be something that comes. That is not a solution. Once a peace solution has been found, it means that unnecessary sanctions will not be imposed upon the losing party, such that ultimately harms the people. And the final point that I would say is that many Muslims should be friendly for Arabs and Syrians, and also for the Muslim Ummah, who at the moment on social media is being misguided. So we hope and pray for a positive outcome within the Arab world and for peace, justice, and the protection.
We have approximately 1 minute left. There's still a quick political donors who can actually give us like this a Discord. I think we might need to do the bullet points and then to wrap it up so we can move
in again. As we said, Hillary must face throughout the world. He says, we must pray for peace and for the world to be saved from all forms of extinction and calamity. We must pray because our master, the Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace is also taken only to establish a loving union between man and his creator and his spread to his family.
This is perfect for each other in reality. It takes us back to where we began at the beginning of the program, which is in terms of what's the cause of this conflict and therefore what's the solution to really the failure to the Jew race as well. Approximately the rest of nations, which is a wider issue, which we perhaps haven't gone into so much today, but the real problem is really is how do we treat our fellow human beings and how do nations and governments respect the rights of those people living in their countries. And I think the big step and the key message that we need to take heed of within the United Nations is to really respect the human rights, but also, as we say from Billy Bahoon, you can do it and we can help. So this is the only advice of the people for this man. If we're going to bring about peace, if we're going to bring about a real lasting solution of harmony for amongst the Arab nations and within Syria, it really has to come from the Arab nations themselves. And I think this is what the Quran is saying, and this is what the Islam is saying in this specific problem. So, once again, Billy, thank you. It's been a handle of very, very interesting story, and I think we've been thanked our guests for the career for joining us, for the invitation to join us in the studio to watch this. And also the Brother Fahim, and I think the USA, the Brother Tamim from Jordan, to back in on the best of the journeys. And we would also like to thank you for watching this, because it's our first anniversary of this ability. It's been 1 year, so please join us again next month on Sunday, 4 p.m. for another episode of Quest Point. And as well, please remember us in the press, and please also remember us for the people and the other nations in the world, and the present way.
We have rules that can understand times of extremism. To denounce terror and extremism.
30,000 people formed a human chain in the south this afternoon in the name of peace.
We're asking if religious intolerance is on the rise.
We believe that religious freedom is a fundamental human right.
Giving a message that Islam is a religion of peace.
We must all endeavor to prepare love and a sense of community.